Let's get started. Good morning to all. I know some of us have chatted and some are saying they're not video worthy, so there's some of us video, some not. And that's okay. So what we'll do is we're going to jump right in. We're going to follow the same format that we've been doing. We'll do a little bit of review on what we've been talking about. That way we can build on it instead of trying to remember, well, what did we say the first week and what did we say the second week. We're going to review and then build on that, and we'll go from there. So let me start the screen share. All right. Then, there we go. All right, everybody see that well? Thumbs up, thumbs up. Thank you, Amy. And then, all right. So let's go ahead and we'll jump right into review here. We're going to talk about our objectives, because the whole idea of something like this is we have an objective to accomplish. So our objective, so I to identify characteristics, gain a better understanding of each generation. Oops. Improve communication, resulting in stronger teamwork. Understand our role in communications across generational groups. And then finally, we want to push us forward as a team. Now, again, in our time together, we will not use this as a time to take inventory of ways we dislike other generations. I have not heard any of that chatter. As we've been covering this, I think we're doing that rather well right now. We won't concentrate on differences. We will not use anything we learn here as ammunition against other generations, and we will not create a label to apply to anyone. In our time together, we will use this as a time to take inventory of ways we admire those of other generations. When I was preparing for this morning, there were a couple of things I'm looking at, like, man, that's really good stuff. So I think we're accomplishing that for sure. We want to concentrate on our similarities, use everything we learn to strengthen our bonds of unity as an apostolic family. And then finally, we will culminate with a time of dedication to the Lord. Now, today at the end, we're going to talk about some of the ways we're going to do that the next time we meet. So keep that in mind for sure. Now, the generations that we opened with were the traditionalists. And they were before 1945, boomers, which started at about 46 and goes to 64, Generation X, which is 65 to 1980, millennials, which are 1981 to 97 or 98, depending on who you talk to. Most agree that it's probably 97. And then Gen Z, which is that about 98 or so to 2019. So that is where we are. Now, each generation contributes positive traits and significant challenges. Traditionalists, boomers, Xers, millennials, Gen Z, everyone does that. So, what makes up, sets apart one generation from another? Shared life experiences. We're going to skip over the traditionalists just because, since this is for our world headquarters primarily, we don't have any traditionalists working in, although. We do have within our midst as far as go-to nations. That's why we originally included it. Later on, we'll be really focusing again, just like we did last time we met, on boomers, Xers, millennials, and Gen Z, because that's really the groups that we are dealing with at the world headquarters. But here are some of the events and shared experiences from traditionalists. Boomers, they got their name as a boom, a surge of births after World War II. Feminism, the Vietnam War was huge. So was space travel, Cold War, credit cards. I think every time I say that one, I'm like, that's amazing to me that credit cards were a marker of a generation. But that they were. So Gen X, the fall of the Berlin Wall, the Challenger disaster, personal computers, working mothers, MTV, divorce. Now I know that divorce was before Gen X, but we saw an increase, a huge spike with that affected this generation. So it was a shared life experience. AIDS and the Persian Gulf War. Millennials experienced a child-focused world, school shootings, the first black president, social media, gay marriage legalization, and the development of the Department of Homeland Security. And that goes back up to what we see at the top there, which is 9/11. Department of Homeland Security did not exist before that. That was in response to that. So that obviously was a big marker. And then finally with Gen Z, smartphones, especially the iPhone, has been a marker, a shaper of the generation. Pluto reclassified, still breaks my heart. It's a planet. I don't care what you say. The COVID pandemic, the Me Too movement, BLM, and then we saw a Great Recession. And these are all things that formed Gen Z. I want to hit that Great Recession. It actually, the reason why we say it's a shared life experience, it does affect the way Gen Z spends and saves and how they manage their finances. So it was just a big, big thing. So we did talk about this, what the actual sticking points are: communication, decision-making, dress code, feedback, fun, knowledge transfer, loyalty, meetings, policies, respect, training, and work ethic. These are the sticking points around which we build our workplaces. So we initially talked about, on our second week, we talked about communication, and we defined what communication is. Now, what's the best way to interact with my coworkers? We talked about the way boomers viewed themselves: strong work ethic, competent, ethical, able to handle a crisis, will take responsibility, good communication. What caused that understanding of the way that understanding they have of themselves? And it was everything from TV to email to all of these things on how they want to be understood. And then because of these things, formal memos, heavily trained and formal writing skills, it's amazing how well boomers can write and how effectively they can communicate through that. Grew up watching TV with broadcasts. They've always had a phone. Gen X, how they view themselves at work: confident, competent, ethical, willing to put in extra time to wrap up a project, and they will take responsibility. The difference is, I know we said that with boomers too, remember that the difference is if something needs to be done, boomers will say, I'll take the responsibility and make sure it gets done. Where Xers, if they see something isn't working, they step up and take the responsibility and say, you know what, I'll take one for the team. That's my fault, whether it is or not. So it is same language, but different application for those two generations. So basis of understanding, first internet users, Xers skim web pages. I don't know of one Xer that has ever in their life read an entire web page. We skim, looking for the pertinent information and move on. Multitasking during meetings. Why do we have to meet in person? It's quicker to meet virtually. After this, we're meeting virtually today. After this, I'm meeting with a couple of Xers virtually, because that's what's effective for all of us. Send an email or a direct message. Gen X does not like memos. So again, and this is because it grew up in a global world, embrace new technologies, pagers, cell phones, internet, all of those things. And the mentality of an email is sufficient. Millennials, how they view themselves at work: makes personal friends at work. They view themselves as sociable, and I would agree with that. They think outside of the box, open to new ideas, and are friendly. They dated by text. I still don't understand this one, but like I said, when we met last time, Sheila and I did a lot of our dating on the phone, so I guess it's not different. Instead of hearing voices, we're reading it, so I guess it works the same way, right? They grew up with interactive communications, news feeds, blogs, retail sites. Unlike the boomer, they did not grow up. Oops, I'm having a hard time today. They did not grow up with, I'm just going to skip around today. Let me see. There we go. With one-way communication, they avoid phone calls. The mentality is just text me. And for the love of God, do not leave these people a voicemail. They hate it. I actually know some Xers that feel the same way. So, basis of understanding, vowels are optional in text. They'll replay a whole speech online. They connect on socials. And again, I can't believe you're still leaving me a voicemail. Millennials, because they grew up with smartphones, wireless video games, texting, the world has always been at their fingertips. So Gen Z, again with Gen Z, they're so new. We're still learning, and we may not have this right. We may see that this changes in the next 5 to 10 years, but right now what we know is they are efficient, and I would agree with that. They're still trying to figure this whole thing out, and they ask the question: is this a grown-up job? So again, smartphone in hand, it's shaped communication. They expect immediate download speeds. They're the catalyst why we're moving to photo-heavy communication. They approach social media with caution. Email is their overwhelming preferred communication, and they want to help the organization move forward. They believe that email is fine for most things. Why not pick the best tool for the job? And if there are not snacks, it should be an email. So, and it's because, really, email is fine for work, and the best tool for the task is important. So today, let's move on to what we'll cover today. And now we've got all of that. We can slow the pace down a little bit, because we're not doing review. We're not trying to hammer things out. We want to cover three things today, and that's decision making, feedback, and fun at work. And I put an exclamation point there, so I guess I should say fun at work. So that's going to be where we are. So let's start with decision making. Now, decision making is probably the most important thing that we do as an organization. And honestly, decision making can be the most difficult thing in some situations. Now, let's talk about how decision making has changed. Boomers caused a huge shift in a good way, in my opinion, and a huge shift in the way that we move forward as an organization. So, boomers pushed organizations to give a voice. Before the boomers were in the workplace, there was no there was no part of the decision-making process. Basically, it was top down, and you were just told, and boomers wanted a voice, and they pushed for that. Now, what we need to remember is boomers had the mentality of never tell the leader he's wrong. That was their approach, the never tell the leader he's wrong approach. Part of that is because, to be honest, it would not have worked with traditionalists. If boomers would have came in and just said, "You're doing this wrong, you're doing that wrong," they probably would have found themselves without a job. And they wouldn't have lasted very long, because the thing is when they entered the workplace, there was an influx. It was a huge generation, an influx of people, and there were more people than there were jobs. So you had to think, how can I do things? How can I be a part of something without alienating myself or getting myself fired? So what they did when they started pushing to have a voice in this decision-making process is they use tools to express correction up. So instead of just telling the boss you're doing this wrong, they developed these tools from process decision-making, committees, research. Research was key for boomers to have a voice in the decision-making process. They did not just come in and demand it. They wanted it, but unlike some, they did not feel like it was their, they were entitled to it, but they did want a voice in it. So what they would do is they would take all of their research, and they would go from all of their research, they would take all of their processes they went through, all of the committees. They would form committees, and they would talk amongst the committees. They would also go through and talk to each individual employee and get their take on it. So then what they would do is then they would take all of that and bring that to their leader, That way, they were not telling the leader he was wrong, but they were showing him what the overall consensus was, what the overall opinion was. And they did it through research. So they could tell the boss he was wrong without saying the words, "You're wrong." Now, as far as boomers, what we think, like this is what they think as far as decision making. We use decision making processes, and the leaders ultimately decide. This is not the way younger generations think, but this is the way boomers think. Is their part of the decision making process is research and putting it in front of the leaders. Their idea was, if we give enough proof, enough evidence, if we give enough research, then they can't think anything else. So, but it was ultimately up to them. I did my part. I did all the research. Now it's up to you to make the right decision. Now, why do they think that way? Boomers used surveys, quality circles, and process mapping. Some people don't know what process mapping is. That's where you look at the processes that drive the results and you map out what the actual results are. So they used surveys, quality circles, and process mapping to give criticism to their leader. And honestly, after I put this together and I looked at criticism, I don't know if it would necessarily be criticism, but I don't know if they even thought, because I'm not a boomer, I don't know if they thought it as criticism as much as they thought of, we need something that's better for all of us. Because boomers really look at things as far as what's equitable, what's good for everybody. So I really believe that was probably probably a better way to put it than criticism to their leader. Now, Gen X. When we're talking about Gen X and we're talking about decision making, we have to understand some things. First of all, many, if not most, Gen X were raised in a non-traditional family. What we saw is that's formational for Gen X, and I referred to this earlier, of the rising divorce rate. So since the divorce rate was so high, what we saw is families that it wasn't necessarily a mother and a father. Sometimes it was a mother and a stepfather. Sometimes it was a mother and a family friend. For a while, when I was younger, my mom and one of her best friends decided that we should all live together. My mom and my sister and I and this woman and her two kids. That way they can share bills and they can share responsibilities and help parent each other's kids. And someone was always there. My mom worked midnights. This woman worked during the day. So there was always a parent available to the kids, but it was a very non-traditional way. The technology became a huge thing for those of us that were in Gen X. We saw the advent of the personal computer. We saw electric typewriters. We saw word processors, all of these things that made learning and decision-making easier. We learned to get help where we could. Again, since where it's non-traditional, maybe dad wasn't there, or because there's non-traditional and mom had to work, mom wasn't there, we learned to get help where we could. It was not a problem for us to ask somebody for help, whether it be a teacher or a librarian, just an adult in the store. We learned to get help where we could. To push us forward so we could get where we wanted to get. And then it came to the point, because of that, what was formational for Gen X in the divorce is, if you knew the most, you made the decision. We learned as a generation that because there was not a strict gender role, because there wasn't always a dad in the home, we could learn from anybody. And whoever knew the most, they are the ones who made the decision. So what we think, this is Gen X, what we think, seek out consensus, but whoever is the most savvy on the topic decides. It doesn't necessarily have to be the leader. For Gen X, there's a value in the leader recognizing that someone has some expertise and allowing them to make the decision because they're the most savvy. Why we think this way? Gen X learned from the technology and non-traditional families to let the savviest person on the topic make the call. It just makes sense to Gen X as a generation. Why wouldn't you let the person who knows the most make the decision if it's good for all of us? Millennials. Millennials, they did group projects. They made decisions without anyone actually being in charge. And I always found that interesting. I'm like, does that actually work? Does it actually work where you have a group of people without someone being in charge and things moving forward? I think what happens is informal leaders rise up where we may not formally say, well, this person's in charge, but personalities will come to the surface and expertise and those sorts of things. But decisions were made without an actual person being in charge. They learned conflict resolution without involving a teacher. The interesting thing is millennials were taught, and again, these are generalizations. Not everybody is this way. Not every school was this way, but these are generalizations that we see happening. What we saw is these young kids in elementary school were taught to how to do conflict resolution. They had a mediator and they took care of it without involving the teacher. So that impacts their decision-making process, where we'll see that they don't always think the leader needs to make the decision. Why can't the group make the decision for what's best for the group? They're looking for broad, more inclusive decision-making. And it goes back to group projects, conflict resolution without involving a teacher. We see these sorts of things. Now, millennials, what we think? We work through the options and decide together. If we can't decide, our leaders decide. So what we see here is it goes back to the group decides. The group will make a decision on what's best for the group, as opposed to one person dictating. This was a huge shift, even away from, we saw it begin with Gen X, but this was saying, we don't need the leader to decide, we can decide for ourselves, and then we will let the leader know. Now the leader will have the tie-breaking decision, but we'll make the decision for ourselves without the leader involved. Why we think that way? Millennials learned arbitration and group decision-making school skills in grade school. Now, one of the things that I do want to point out here is often we'll say that it's this way because the millennials are bringing things in from school, which is true. But research shows us that millennials aren't the first generation to do that. We often say, oh, well, the millennials are all bringing this, what they learned in from school. The first generation to actually do that were the boomers. The boomers set the pace for it because when they came in, and we'll see this during the feedback, when they came into the workplace, they wanted some standardized things. They wanted some measurements, and they brought decision making, they brought feedback skills into the workplace that they had learned in school. So the millennials, although this is usually pinned on them, oh, they're the first generation, that's not entirely true. The boomers are the ones who set the pace for this. I don't have a problem with it personally. My attitude is like, well, if you learned it in school, it was obviously a skill we should learn. So why not use it in the workplace if it's going to benefit the whole? So that would be it. So they did learn decision-making skills in grade school and have just carried it along the way. Now, Gen Z. Gen Z tends to have mixed feelings about collaborative work. And you're going to see some of that in the way they talk about collaborative work because they will point out who does all of the work and who doesn't do any of it. So they have some mixed feelings about it. They like it because it's a sharing of ideas, but they want to make sure that the work is all spread out. As far as decision making, they find out what members are good at and have them do that. And that helps with decision making. Parents were more supportive than previous generations, but the generation received more critical feedback. In prior generations, what you saw is there was less involvement and less feedback from the parent. It was generally what they got was only negative if they got any at all. With this generation, the parents were involved, the parents were supportive, but they were also quick to say that's not good enough. I can attest that I was that parent at times where, oh, you could do better. So yeah, they did receive more critical. They want the bosses, the leaders, to ask questions and to listen to their ideas. When you are leading or managing Gen Z, please remember this one. ask their opinions, and listen to their ideas. Now, this does not mean that just because they gave their idea, you have to put it in place. That's not generally the way Gen Z thinks, but they do want to feel heard. They want to hear listened to. So we must learn skills when it comes to decision-making, feedback, anything. We must learn the skills to make them understand that we are listening. So why we think this way, seek out ideas, aim for consensus, but whoever is the most savvy or experienced decides. Now, with this one, that's interesting is it's been said by some, I've heard this and seen this in a few different places, that Gen Z has taken the best of the boomers and the best of the Xers, and that's what they are as a generation. And just this right here, if you look at it, it's got the same sort of language that Gen X uses. And it's got a flavor of boomer that the most experienced. So the leader, the person in charge, is going to be the decision maker. So this is something that we really want to keep in mind with Gen Z, is it definitely plays out that they take the best of the boomers and the best of the Xers. It plays out in the way they think. Now, why we think this way for Gen Z? Growing up in groups taught Gen Zs to avoid those who do not pull their own weight. This has influenced everything. And I would venture a guess, and I'm trying not to speak to it as an expert because I'm still learning a lot about Gen Z. This puts them in a place where they are suspicious at times, and they want everybody to prove, to make sure that we're all doing our part. And I'm trying not to speak, again, that's my impression. I could be wrong, but this is where all the evidence is pointing. So this decision-making brings us right into feedback. Feedback. Now, when we're talking about feedback, the important thing for us to remember is this is communicating from leaders to the individual. Why is it important? How do they use this to measure performance, advancement, anything that impacts their work experience? This is why feedback is important. Now, boomers, as I said earlier, they pushed for formal feedback. They're the ones that brought in, well, in school, we had all of these standardized things. Boomers wanted it in the workplace as well. This is where we came up. We got annual performance appraisals. Really, before boomers, you did not see this. You didn't really know how you were doing unless maybe the boss was upset, unless the leader didn't like what you were doing. There was no appraisal. These appraisals, big deal. I can't stress enough. That's why I capitalized big. They were a big, big deal. They were done usually, again, annually, see, once a year, and it measured everything. The most important thing that we have to remember, this decided promotability. A bad performance appraisal could be career, life, or death. If you got one, because again, there were more people than there were jobs. So if there's one promotion and there's 15 people up for it, if you get a bad performance appraisal, you're running into a problem. And because there was so many, there were times that since there was only one promotable position, you couldn't recover from it. Like I said, life or death. You wanted the best possible you could get. So, boomers, what we think, annual performance appraisals and quarterly one-on-one meetings with the leader allow employees to know where they stand. Again, I want us to understand when we look at that statement, is this is a top-down model. It is where we stand with the boss. The boss, the annual appraisal, this is what we see in your performance. One-on-ones, this is what we see. I will say, I want to take a moment right now. I know at GoToNations, we have one-on-ones. This is not the kind of one-on-ones we are and should be doing with GoToNations. Our one-on-ones should be more engaging. What we should be doing, our model at GoToNations is to be more engaging. What do you need from me? How can I help you? What is it that you need to talk to me about? Those kind of conversations. These meetings, these one-on-ones that I'm talking about were more performance-oriented, directive from leadership down on what it is. It was like a little, it wasn't necessarily a performance appraisal, but it was a little mini appraising of where you stand at the moment. So Gen X. Now I'm going to be honest. I struggled with some of these because I was like, maybe this, nope, this isn't right. And I said, well, maybe it is, maybe it's not. And then I realized that that's just, that's a generational marker that we don't necessarily trust everything. And we kind of fight against it. And our group, when we were met last, after our last meeting, we even talked about that, that difficult to trust thing. And so I'm thinking, I'm seeing that play out a little bit as I prepared. So even some things on here, I may not necessarily agree with, but this is what research shows us. So with Gen X, appraisals meant less to them. They were not so much life or death to a career. They viewed them as too much of an afterthought. The book talks about this, and you know, I had a conversation with Nancy the other day about a whole, it wasn't anything to do with work. It was a different situation. And I said, how can you say to me, I wasn't saying this to Nancy, I was using this as an example. I said, how can you tell me that you're upset about something from 8 years ago? How can I fix that? That is a supremely Gen X mentality. And that is what performance appraisal was. It's views, it's too much of an afterthought. In the book, it talks about how can you appraise me in November about something that happened in December or January. That is the way Gen X looks. It's like, it's, we're like, it's too late now. I can't fix it. That's what it was then. They want, Gen X wants real time feedback. Don't wait until months after. Gen X will sometimes not receive that well and may even feel blindsided or attacked in ways because it's like, well, what can I do? It puts a defensive posture. Even if that's not the intent, even if it's not anything other than this is just what was observed, it will, it's just a generational marker. Real time. If you messed up Tuesday, talk about it on Wednesday. When it goes months or even a year later, it feels like a blindside. So they speak openly to others and the leaders, so they don't think feedback should be so complicated. A lot of times Gen X don't even think that there needs to be a yearly appraisal. It's a matter of, gosh, if there was something that we needed to talk about, then why didn't you talk about it then? Or why didn't we address this when it happened? And then also, do we need a piece of paper to fill out? Can't we just have a conversation as two grown-ups that trust each other and work together and have a common goal? This is a Gen X mentality. So, what we think? Gen X, people that respect each other don't need a form or a meeting. They just say what they think. It can become, for Gen X, a respect me issue. If we wait too long, or if it's done on a piece of paper, we have to have a formalized meeting. It can be, if we really respect each other, we're just gonna be honest and direct. Why we think that way? Gen Xers often consider formal performance appraisals too complicated and untimely. They talk candidly to each other and to those in authority who demonstrate they can handle the honesty. It is not uncommon for Gen X to say, I'm not going to say anything because they're not ready to hear it. They think real-time feedback is essential to getting work done efficiently. The mentality is if I'm doing something that hinders productivity or hinders what we're doing as an organization, and you tell me 4 months, 5 months, 6 months later, then we just lost all of that time. So real-time feedback is very important for Gen X. So millennials, they grew up with constant feedback. There was always something. Social media provides instant feedback. They want now feedback instead of waiting for a review. Then they can adjust as needed. What's often used as an example in the book here is the scoreboard when you're playing a video game. You know how many lives you have, what your score is. You know everything constantly, what's happening. Every time you do something good, the scoreboard changes. And if you're not doing great, you can adjust your approach. So that's very, very much an effector and very important for millennials. Now, what we think, just put the score on the screen like in a video game, so there's instant feedback. It is great if it's possible to give this generation feedback immediately when a project is done, or immediately when after, if you've done a conference or you've gone somewhere, if they've taught a class, at the end of class, if you can give them some sort of immediate feedback, this is perfect for this generation, because that is what they are accustomed to and they thrive on. So why we think this way? Millennials were raised by boomer parents who focused on their self-esteem and used listening and problem-solving skills. Video games also provided them with instantaneous feedback. Think scores. This is a strong thought for most millennials. Again, we're speaking in generalized terms, but this is a thing for us to think about, is how are they scoring? What are they doing? It is very much the way they think. Gen Z, even more important to them than millennials to have right now feedback. Some organizations give a daily appraisal. This is what you did great today. And even a couple of times a day, this is what you did great. They experienced less of the good try, which is what the millennials heard, and more of the, you need to redo that. And again, it goes from, they were generally raised by a different generation than the millennials. They highly value a supportive leader who will listen. This one is probably one of the most important things for us to understand when we're talking about Gen Z. They want a supportive leader who will listen. If you're supporting them, but they don't feel heard by you, they don't feel like you are actually being supportive. So highly value supportive leaders who will listen. Now, I do want to say that supportive leaders doesn't necessarily mean you did such a good job, you are so wonderful. They don't always trust that. That does not feel real. There are many different ways, and we're still learning what supportive leaders mean, but supportive leaders who will listen to them. Very, very key. What we think, show me how to win and be clear about how I'm doing, but don't forget emotional support. Now, we have to be careful of the way we're giving emotional support. We do not want to give emotional support in a placating kind of way. We want to give genuine emotional support. If a leader can't give abundant coaching, this is the mentality that most Gen Z have. If a leader can't give abundant coaching, they're not a leader. Why do we think that way? Gen Z got clear feedback from the amount of likes on their social media and were not told by their parents that they could achieve anything and to believe in themselves. Okay, that's a poorly structured sentence. Let me help you out with this. So they had immediate likes. They'd see how many likes they got on social media. They were not like millennials. Millennials were constantly being told by their parents, you could achieve anything and to believe in yourself. Gen Z didn't hear that so much. They weren't necessarily told that they could do everything or anything. And they weren't told to believe, if all they had to do was believe in themselves. They were told, because they were taught by what their parents, who were Gen X, who believed, Gen X tend to believe they were more pragmatic, wanted to be honest with them and say, it takes more than believing in yourself. You got to work hard. So there is this shift and there is this difference. They were told to redo things. They did not hear, well, you tried and all that, that's all that matters. They didn't hear the, well, that's good enough. They heard, you can do better, redo it. So, fun at work. Everybody say, yay, yay. Okay, that's good enough. I got Amy. So, fun at work. Boomers, they were the first to expect more than just money from work. They, traditions came in, and even before then, you went to work because that's where the money was made. Boomers wanted more than just money from work. MASH. Does anybody know the TV show MASH? Anybody? It's really weird to do it this way. Well, I can't see everybody. So I'm going to say some people yes and some people no. MASH was a TV program that started in the late 70s and went into the 80s. It was one of the longest running TV shows in history. And it was a medical mobile army something hospital. I can't remember. I don't know. I'm not military, guys. Don't crucify me. Sorry. But it was a mobile hospital, and they would treat soldiers that had been injured on the battlefield. And it was during the Korean War. It was set time for the TV show. It came from a movie, and it was marked by irreverent humor. It wasn't always clean, but the humor was all about making fun of what's happening, laughing at their situation, and just kind of pushing through. And this is where boomers really pulled the idea of, we can have fun at work. It's possible to go to work and have fun. But here's what we have to remember. Boomers, for the most part, think work is fun. The actual work, what they're actually doing, they tend to view that as fun. If you want to see a really happy boomer, experience them on a day that's just been successful. Like everything just fell into place. They got a lot done, maybe even more than what they had planned. And they'll tell you, man, it was such a fun day. And all they did was work. They just did their work. This is, for the most part, the way boomers view things. Work is fun. So, boomers, what we think. Fun matters, but not as much to us. The work itself should be fun. And it doesn't really matter what kind of work they're doing. This isn't isolated to one kind of work. They think that working is fun. Boomers, why we think that way? For early boomers, post-war optimism assumed life would continue to unveil new, exciting, and engaging opportunities. Work would be no different. They expected work to be exciting and engaging and fun, and they just knew that it was going to be. It was the supreme optimism of a successful war. Now, Gen X. And when I was putting this one together, I laughed because I've been known to say this. Gen X, they think life is too short to do something they do not enjoy. I've been known to say, if it's not fun, it's not worth doing. But they don't expect work to be fun. They don't expect work to be fun. They will say boomers try to make work something it's not fun. You will rarely hear an Xer say that work is fun. Xers tend to enjoy their work, but do not think of it as fun. This is why mixing in fun is key. Now, what in effort to meet this need, what boomer leaders have done, boomer managers, boomer bosses, what they've done is they've planned certain fun days, certain things to be fun, certain fun activities, or ways to make work fun. Gen X pushes back on that. They say fun should not be planned because it feels forced. This is one that I had a hard time with because, let me tell you, some of our fun days around the office, I have a lot of fun with, and I like them. And I'm like, why don't we do a fun day? So I guess this is, again, this is a broad generalization, but this is the way most people think. It feels forced. Allow for enjoying the moment and humor. What we see is in the clash between boomers and Xers, right, in the workplace, is boomers say work is fun. Just doing the work, I'm having fun. This is great. And Xers want to take about 2 minutes and laugh at something, poke fun at one another, make some sort of joke, and enjoy the moment. And boomers are saying, you stopped the fun to distract us. We were having fun working. So this is where it is. It's just, it is a different, there's two different sets of views. So really, when you're leading Xers, just remember, allow for enjoying the moment and a little bit of humor, maybe ribbing each other, picking on each other in the process. And that's what makes it fun for this generation. What we think, it's work. Quit trying to make it something it's not. If the work isn't inherently fun, the culture can be. That's what we were just talking about when we're saying that allow there to be an enjoyment of the moment. What that is doing is that's creating a culture where people can have a good time together and have fun together. Why we think that way? For Gen Xers, fun would be great as long as they get their work done and it gets done on time. This is a value. Work completion and getting it completed on time is a huge value for Gen X. Plus, today's organizations can't promise stability and prosperity in the global technological economy. Work is a place to earn a living first. Whatever fun or satisfaction comes along is just bonus. Millennials. Remember, we talked about last time we met that millennials are far more social. They brought this social aspect into the workplace. Fun is fuel. That social mentality. Fun is fuel. Playfulness and humor has been deeply integrated into every aspect of life. Two-thirds say they want friends at work. Two-thirds of millennials say they want fun at work. They see themselves as more fun than Gen X, but they are shifting their fun to personal life. Now, they want fun at work. They want friends at work, but there is, as they're getting older and their families are more developed, they are seeing they want more in their personal life than at work, but they still want that at work. I think it's very funny that you've got one generation that says it's work, it's not meant to be fun. And then the next generation right after them say, well, we're more fun than they are. That really shows how big this generational shift is. Millennials ushered in a huge thing. And I will say that some of these things, like this fun and having friendships, relationships at work, this is key. And it builds continuity, connection. And as we say, we're an apostolic family. This mentality of millennials really does help build that apostolic family in a new and fresh way. So this is really, as I was putting this together, I'm like, man, this is something that we really all could learn about is what this means. So what we think, I'll get more done if we have fun. I've actually heard millennials say this because a no fun work environment for them is literally a drag. It drags them down. It slows them down in their work. Why we think this way? For millennials, serious things are supposed to be fun. Sesame Street made learning fun. School made learning interactive. Work should too. Now, Gen Z, we're getting ready to wrap up here. Gen Z, they tend to be more serious about success than millennials. We're seeing that they're finding identity at work. What they do, again, this is a boomer mentality. What they do is part of their identity. So they're going to be a little bit more serious at work than their previous generation. They're more cautious about what they share at work. You will find that millennials, I'm sorry, that Gen Z at times, they have a whole different lifestyle outside of work than you would think because they're very cautious and protective about what they share. And they don't necessarily, when you're talking about social media, they won't necessarily friend their leader on social media, follow on Instagram, any of those things. They won't necessarily because they create a separation between work and private life. They want fun, flexible work environment. And what's interesting is if it's not flexible, it can't be fun. So fun and flexible go hand in hand. And then remember, their humor is different. It's silly, it's quirky, it's self-deprecating. Older folks, really, Xers and boomers, we have a hard time getting their humor. You know, like the program The Office. I tried so hard. All of these Gen Z around me were talking about how funny The Office is. I like to watch a funny TV show, and I turned it on and I suffered. Let me tell you honestly, I suffered through the first two or three episodes, and at the end I was like, that wasn't funny. I don't get any of it. And Gen Z, my Gen Z compatriots just looked me square in the eyes and said, it's because you're too old. It's because you're too old. So I don't know if that's
That was
it.
the Gen Z program.
I'm sorry. Somebody just said something. Who is iPhone? Okay, we'll move on. That's fine. We just don't get it, right? So, Gen Z, what we think? I keep the humor at work and in my personal life separate until I know I will be taken seriously. This is something to understand is they may come into the workplace and not engage on a personal level until they know that you take them seriously. It's not that they're trying to hide anything. They're building up their identity and their reputation before they'll let you know of the silly, quirky, self-deprecating humor. Finally, Gen Zs were taught to err on the side of restraint, to put success before preferences, and to read the situation before they brought their whole fun self to work. This is what we want to understand is we see this in like the way they dress, right? When millennials were younger, they dressed more vibrantly. Gen X was the same way, more vibrantly, more brought the attention to themselves. If you talk to Gen Z, there's everything is muted. It's calmed down. It's not as out there. And what they're doing is they're creating an aesthetic and they're creating a way that they are to be viewed. So, closing, this is where we are, right? This is the idea today was to was we're trying to land this plane. Our next one, we're gonna land, and we're gonna land smoothly with some things that we're gonna do, some activations and some personal things as a family. But I really thought it was important for us to understand, because we talked about what are the actual shapers of the generation, then we talked about communication. If we understand how to communicate, we understand how decisions and everybody want decisions to be made. We understand how to give and receive feedback, and we can look at what's fun. It really puts us in a situation where we can be more successful and we can be more cohesive as a team. Now, with that being said, are there any questions? Does anybody have any questions, comments, anything that we need to hit on? Wow, okay. I did phenomenal, not one question. So so our next meeting is Chris and Asko, am I saying this correctly? If I say that we're meeting on the 3rd, is it next week we're meeting? The 10th. We're meeting on the 10th. Okay.
Next week is Global Encounter, so 10th.
Oh, there you go. So we're meeting on the 10th. Now, Nancy had asked that we all meet as our generational groups and we discuss roadblocks, we discuss ungodly belief systems, we prepare how do we change our ungodly beliefs generationally into godly beliefs. The other thing that she talked about was repentance. And what I would like to do is I would like to throw onto that. So I know that everybody should have met. I don't know about your generational leaders. I know that Dave was on it, and we've already met once, and we've got another meeting coming up as a generation. So I know I talked to some of the I talked to the Gen Z folks. I don't know if they've had their meeting yet, but I know they've got it planned. But anyway, what I would like to throw on that is we want to have a time of repentance. Also, what are judgments that you are holding against other generations that you need to address? And you need to publicly repent. We repent that we did this or that we have said these things because we're trying to get away from all of those dividers. Again, it's all about cohesive. How do we become a strong, cohesive apostolic family that is accomplishing the mission that's in front of us? We must remember the mission in front of us. Anything that distracts us from the mission is not of the Lord. So we've got to get rid of it all and really want to push through. So, and additionally, I just want to add, what are things, two or three, it doesn't have to be a lot, that you can repent for. And I don't mean two or three per the other generations, but two or three total that you can repent to the other generations. Like, we've held this against you and we need to stop. And we are sorry, please forgive us. We'll also spend time in communion. And I want to throw it over to you, Nancy, if there's anything that you want to add to that or to today or whatever.
Thank you, Chris. Good job. It's good to see everybody. We don't normally meet right before Thanksgiving, so it's good. We had a builders, our bi-weekly or bi-monthly builders meeting that ran over this morning. So I was a little bit late. So how do y'all feel like your meetings are going? You said everybody's met, but the Gen Z, is that right, Chris?
I'm not for sure. I know that I've seen that Gen Z either scheduled or about to. If one of them could pipe in and say to give
we
us
did meet. Great.
You did meet, I guess. Yeah.
And the millennials, were they able to meet?
We have not met yet. We're planning on meeting today.
Okay, great. Well, there are a few things, and I knew, like, I started off our boomers meeting, like, I have no idea how easy or complicated this is going to be, or if we'll even be able to fully meet our objectives. But I do know that from the moment I got this revelation, within a week, 2 weeks, we started getting revelation and traction on our recruiting and mobilizing the next generation, where we've been pretty stuck for about 4 or 5 years since it started right pre-COVID. So I know that I know that I know that God is in this, and we have to walk through this by the Spirit. So really, you're going to have to seek God for each of your generations about what God is saying, because this is going to require all of us to press in and be led of the Holy Spirit. You know, Dr. Jerry and Beverly, Sandra Barfield was there as well, but are the oldest in our boomer generation that was meeting, and they really struggle. First of all, there's not one thing in the whole chapter about boomers that Jerry could relate to because of his individual experience as a boomer growing up. He wasn't told he was special or he could do whatever he wanted to do, or, you know, it was just the exact opposite with his family background. And so there's two paradigms here. One, if you read that chapter and say, I fully relate or I don't relate at all, then that could be a challenge. But then you have the other paradigm, is that Go to Nations has worked so hard in the builder generation. You know, we had the pioneers first 20 years, the last second 20 years was the builder, where we're working to address the challenges and the problems that the pioneers who got this organization off the ground by being those wild cowboys that went out into the Wild West and did the daring things and got movement started. I mean, it was bold, it was passionate, and God used it. But there were not all missionary families, but there were problems in a lot of marriages and parenting and morals and ethics, and not across the board, but there were definitely issues. So we spent the next 20 years addressing those challenges because we knew that they weren't reproducible. And from there, I would say over the last 10 years, we are far more kingdom culture in our practices than we have ever been as a whole, like not just in the headquarters, definitely headquarters, but in the entire global field force than we have ever been in our history. And I'll give you an example. I can't remember how you said it, Chris, about the boomers and you don't criticize your boss, or you don't go and directly and complain. But I thought about this. We've learned over the last decade how to make an appeal an appeal that is biblical and godly. And, you know, the first thing we started seeing is that correction always comes top down, not bottom up. But if I have an offense with Dr. Jerry personally, then I'm to practice biblical conflict resolution in the same way with him that I would with an X or a millennial or a Gen Z. It's like, hey, when this happened, this is what I heard. Is that what you said? So again, we've learned practices that our kingdom, how to put these things into play in a way that will reach the heart and that will be honorable. So no matter what generation it is. So the two paradigms is one, if you read the chapter and you can't relate at all. And the other one, if you've been practicing godly principles that are more kingdom culture for so long, it's hard for you to dissect. And I think that's where Dr. Jerry and Beverly were. And so we took us like 30 minutes talking through, which then I kind of laughed. And I said, well, that's kind of a boomer mentality, actually. And so then, but it took us about 30 minutes. Then the next 40 minutes, we started really getting somewhere. So, and then the last thing I would like to share is Sandra Barfield, and I don't want to do a spoiler alert, but she really caught that the boomers were the first ones that really introduced the whole left woke culture. But then I thought about it later. It's like, yes, it was true. It's like, I was so glad to hear what she had to share. But it was also the boomers who brought in all the ingenuity and all the creativity and all the innovation and all of the things. So we say there's more lives saved now because of medicine and science and technology than ever. But I mean, the rate of how long people live has gotten longer and long, you know, longer and longer than what it was. So these things need to be discussed, and that you can't do a lot of that in 1 hour. So I feel like we're going to see more of this carried out into 2025. But here's where I'm going with that. With every strength, we say our greatest strength is our greatest weakness, and our greatest, you know, gifting can also be your greatest vulnerability. So it depends on the character, the wholeness of Christ, you know, the more your soul reflects Christ, how the expression of what your strength or your gifting, how it's going to be released. And we know we don't all walk 100% in the spirit. We have good days. We have bad days. We have vulnerable days. We have days where the devil's ganging up on us. The Lord lifts the grace a little bit because he's highlighting an area of our heart that he's wanting to do some work in. Now he's done all this. Now he wants to work on this. So we recognize all that. But as you go in here, like if you pull back the veil and you say, okay, as a whole, my generation thinks this way, or they have a propensity to do this. I mean, we all kind of laughed. I told Tim, like the boomers, they consider, like, it's hard to get them to retire and to stop being the bosses and get them out of the workplace. And what was it? They consider being old. I think it was at 78 or something like that. And the average lifespan for a boomer is 79.5. I told Tim that, and he started laughing and gave me a high five. I said, that is so boomer for us to do that, you know? So there is some, that confidence that can come across as arrogance. And so we have to break those things down and say, Lord, what is it that in our organization, you know, that we can take some psychological ownership of within our generations and ask God to forgive us and then replace that. It's an ungodly belief or mindset, and then replace that with a godly one. So I have confidence in you that y'all are going to get where you need to go. But I also believe that this is going to be a stepping stone, and we'll probably have some more work to do on this next year or the year, you know. But I believe God's breathing on it, and he's going to give us the discernment and the wisdom how to do it. So, and I hope I didn't belabor that, Chris, but thank you.
No, you're good.
Thank you for the time you've invested in this to bring all these things to our attention. It's very encouraging. And I think about osmosis, you know, in science. I don't remember exactly technically. I just remember the diagram, but where things from here are then coming down into this water, you know, and you have a transfer. So it's kind of like the brain. If you think about a tapestry, with all the different threads. And so Jesus said, let the wheat and the tares grow together, because if you come and try to remove the tares or the weeds, you know, those roots run really deep, then you can unearth the root system of the new wheat, or, you know, that's growing, the good things that's growing. It's the same thing in our brain. So God doesn't tackle everything at one time, because he can unearth and disrupt the growth of the good things that he's planted inside of us. So this really is a tremendous spiritual exercise that we are, you know, endeavoring to tackle, because there are godly things that are at work within our culture as an organization that are truly kingdom, that have surpassed the different generational mindsets. But then there's also the vulnerability of those generational mindsets that are tainted a little bit, that are woven, you know, all this water's kind of moving together, or the tapestry, they're all in here together. So it's going to take some real delicate work of the Holy Spirit and sensitivity, but I believe we're going to get what we need to get. So sorry, I tend to get so philosophical at times like this. Forgive me.
No, it's very, very good. Very good. I think we needed it.
Yeah. Well, y'all have a happy Thanksgiving. Thank you for decorating. I can't wait to see it when I get back. And we saw Nathan and Allison and Joel and Heidi yesterday. Sunday. What's yesterday? Sunday. We drove up to Boone and had lunch with them and the kids and Jacob and Silas. And, oh, it was just so good to see everybody. And they say hello to you. So, yeah. Have a great, great week. Time off, everybody.